All righty. Well, welcome everybody to our Cooking for Wellness. Tonight is our Chef's Challenge. Chef Jason has four different ingredients covered in front of him that he has no idea what they are until he uncovers them. And we do have the names of the participants who suggested those. So when he uncovers that, we'll go through all of the ingredients and I'll share who did the suggestion. So Chef, if you want to do the unveiling.
Dun, dun, dun. Let's see what you guys have done to me.
What's under there?
So starting from left to right from on my screen, we have albacore canned tuna that was recommended by Maxine. And Chef, I wasn't too sure how much you needed, so I do have two cans. Next to that, and I am not going to be able to pronounce this, maybe Lori or Chef can, but it's the Chinese chili paste.
Yes, it is hard to gochujang.
Yeah, see, that, I'm glad I didn't say it. And that was recommended by Pat Belmont. And then beside that is artichoke hearts. And that was recommended by Ann Niebert. And then right beside that then is our purple cabbage recommended by Wendy Siminski. So we have those four ingredients for Chef. And then Lori, if you wanted, I don't know, I guess you want to share some nutritional tips as Chef's creative juices start to flow in his brain.
Yeah, that sounds good. I definitely can do that. I thought these ingredients were pretty cool. I hope Chef does too. We'll see here. But the first thing, so the gochujang, I think, how do you say it again? That's how when I looked it up, I certainly did not know how to pronounce it. they said gochujang.
How do you spell it?
Gochujang. It's hard to say. It is hard to pronounce.
Yeah. It's
how do you spell it?
G-O-C-H-U-J-A-N-G.
G-O-C-H-U-J-A-N-G.
Thank you. Never heard of it.
So if you'd like to say red chili paste, you can.
It's a Korean chili paste. Right. It's got a little bit of spice to it, but it's really flavorful. It's really good, actually. It's one of my favorite. I like it.
Nice. Good. So that is pretty cool because it's high in protein, it's high in antioxidants and vitamins, but it's low in fat and calories. So it's a really good ingredient to have around. I know that a lot of people compare it to sriracha, but there is no garlic in this product. So that's the biggest difference. I think garlic's super, you know, definitive. So that would be make it more dissimilar in my mind. But we like it because it's got just a few ingredients, the chili powder, the glutinous rice, salt, and fermented soybeans.
Connect to the 9 o'clock. Yeah. He really likes pasta bread.
Okay. So the next ingredient I'm going to talk about is the albacore tuna. So I figured everybody would have a lot of questions about this. There's 2.1 grams of omega-3s in a 3.5 ounce serving of albacore tuna. So we chose that because that's really redeeming. That's the highest or richest in omega-3s of the whole tuna family. We do know that usually there's a concern around the mercury. So the reference dose for a 150 pound person is 47.6 micrograms per week. Okay, so the reference dose kind of speaks to what we think is safe for, you know, this size person, 150 pounds. With albacore tuna, there's 30.4 micrograms in a serving. So if you're trying to stay under 47.6, you know, albacore is something to have once a week, basically, is what I'm going to boil it down to, since there's 30.4 micrograms and our reference range is 47.6. We want to stay under that. So you're safe with one serving a week. If you want to use canned tuna more often than that, I would recommend going with either light tuna or skipjack tuna. They are 10 and 12 micrograms respectively per 3 ounce serving. So you could have, if you're going to use light tuna or skipjack in regards to mercury, you could have that like 3 times a week and still
be. Skipjack? Yeah, what's that?
What's what?
What's skipjack?
Skipjack. It's J-A-C-K, skipjack tuna.
Is that a canned tuna like the others?
Yes. Yeah. It's just the kind of fish. I know not, it's not super common, but you can buy skipjack tuna. Well, I can't really, I don't even know what store carrying that, but I know you can find it. I have seen it canned. So that one would be a little bit lower, or just light tuna. You can go with light tuna. It's also low in regards to the mercury. Like I said, there's trade-offs for each because the albacore is really high in omega-3s. And so that we know that that's helpful. So just kind of consider that as you're planning your week around your tuna. Purple cabbage, we've talked about a bunch, and I know that you probably are counting on me saying that it has that anti-aging compound, the anthocyanins. Those are really helpful in regards to tamping inflammation and kind of slowing disease process. 1 cup of purple cabbage only has 28 calories, and it's got 56% of the RDI for vitamin C. So that's a really nice combination for very few calories. It's also rich in sulforaphane, which is the cancer fighting compound. So that's really nice to know that you've got a bunch of things that are going to be helpful with the purple cabbage. And then our last mystery ingredient is the artichoke, which I love. I absolutely love artichokes. One medium artichoke has 60 calories and 7 grams of fiber. So that's really, really nice. Not very many calories, a ton from fiber. It's high in folate, it's high in vitamin C, high in potassium. And one interesting fact about artichokes is they are number 7 on the USDA's list of 20 of the top 20 antioxidant rich foods. So yeah, so finding a way to incorporate artichokes is a really good idea. They're really redeeming in regards to their nutrition. So hopefully Jason can show us a really cool way to be inspired to start having artichokes included in our meals.
Yes, we wanted to pick up a raw artichoke, but Angie and I were talking about that and we realized it would take 30 minutes to cook and Chef has 30 minutes to in total. So that's why we
I'm glad you didn't, because yes, it would take to break it down and then to cook it, yes, it would take probably 3/4 of the time.
Yes.
And they're really labor intensive, aren't they?
Yes.
Yeah.
Pat left us a chat and she said that the red chili paste, it makes a great barbecue sauce substitution.
Yes, okay. Yes.
Nice.
Well, so what are you thinking there, Chef?
Well, with gochujang, I'm going to go Asian, of course, and this is going to be interesting. But I mean, it's not too much out of the box at all. But I've never made it before. We'll see how it comes out. But I'm gonna make a fried rice.
Ooh.
That's the first thing that came to mind. So I just kind of tend to kind of go with my gut.
What did you say you're going to make? A fried rice?
Yep.
Okay.
I have some brown rice over here in the pot. I'm going to cook real quick.
So, Darlene, who was it that suggested the gochujang?
That was Pat Belmont.
Oh, okay. So I can't see. Is Pat here tonight?
Yes, she is.
So Pat, what made you suggest that particular spice or seasoning?
Oh, Pat, you're still muted.
I like to use it, and I'm just always looking for interesting ways to incorporate it.
Oh, okay. Okay. What
bringing the heat to your diet helps up your metabolism.
Yeah, right. Yes. And the capsaicin has some analgesic effects. So if you have joint pain or any kind of chronic pain, it's helpful. How were you inspired to start using it? Did you travel, or how did you, do you have a favorite restaurant, or how did it happen?
Food Network.
Oh, awesome. I'm addicted to the Food Network. I love it. I feel like Guy Fieri's my best friend. I love watching him. So yeah, that's awesome. Okay, good, good. Okay, so Darlene, who suggested the purple cabbage again? I'm sorry.
That was Wendy.
So Wendy, how do you normally use purple cabbage?
Well, either raw in green salads, or mostly I like it as the German purple cabbage cooked with vinegar.
Oh, yeah.
And apples, and it's really easy to do. And I've done it in the Instant Pot also.
Okay.
So turns out really good.
How many minutes in the Instant Pot?
Well, I don't remember. The Instant Pot is kind of funny because it takes 10 to 20 minutes to warm up. Then there's the actual cooking time. And then there's the decompress time, which is at least another 10 minutes.
Right.
So, but it's nice that you can just walk away and you know you don't have to stir anything or add any liquid. It's just going to all cook all at once. And it came out just right.
Nice. Okay, good. Good to know. So that you do it with the vinegar and apple the most.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. So next, I'm wondering who suggested the artichoke?
I did. Ann.
Oh, okay. Ann. So what inspired the artichoke in your mind?
Well, it's an old memory. Well, first of all, my husband and I have been married 44 years. Okay. But my memory is that when early in our marriage, for a special night out, we would go to Cork and Cleaver restaurant and linger. And they had a nice fireplace and it was a beautiful, lovely, warm place. So we would get the appetizer of artichokes, and that was a whole artichoke with dips. So you would take each leaf off,
yes,
and put it in the dip and then run it across your bottom teeth to get the artichoke meat off.
Yes.
And so there have been times when I tried to prepare it at home, and that's a lot of work. And that involves clipping off or cutting off the sharp points on each of the leaves.
Yeah.
And then I forget how I cooked it or steamed it or whatever I did. So it's a very time intensive thing. Mm. If you want to have a leisurely time spent together like a newlywed would 44 years ago, that you know, it was a lot of fun and we loved it then.
Right.
So I just wondered what, I wouldn't expect Jason to do quite that, but I just wondered what he would do with a fresh artichoke.
Oh, okay. Well, we'll just have to pick his brain on a fresh one since we're doing a 30-minute cooking challenge. And then I know, Maxine, you said the albacore tuna, or did you say canned tuna, or did you pick albacore?
I just took canned tuna, but that's the kind I always use. And I said, or canned chicken.
Oh, okay.
Because I opened my cupboard and I've got all this canned chicken and canned tuna. And I wanted something different other than tuna fish casserole.
Okay. Do you ever make like a tuna salad, like with what I've been doing lately, just kind of like to use my vegetables with my canned tuna or canned chicken, and I'll even do it with hard-boiled eggs. Just do like cucumber, onion, celery, bell pepper, avocado, cilantro, and then I add the tuna. And so like,
what kind of dressing?
Well, that's what I was going to say. The avocado kind of dresses it for you. Like the more you stir that up. And I like it. I like it a lot. I've been doing that just because, I don't know, I'm less inspired in the winter to eat like raw vegetables. And so the cucumber, the celery, the onion, and the bell pepper kind of come together with the cilantro. I think they come together really nicely, especially like when you get your protein in there and then the avocado kind of as a creamier dressing. If you do a little bit of lime juice too, so that would be one thing that you could use your canned chicken or your canned tuna for.
Yeah, or tuna fish sandwiches, so it's like.
Yeah, right.
Yep. Nothing special.
Have you tried doing a drizzle of balsamic vinegar over that?
Sounds good too.
Yeah, I love balsamic. I feel like it does wonders for anything.
How you doing, Chef?
Doing good. Just prepping up some veggies here to go in this quote unquote fried rice.
So what veggies are you adding?
Well, I just have some onion here, what we had here in the pantry, some onions, some red bell pepper. And of course I got some garlic and ginger, because you can't have the start of any great Asian dish without garlic and ginger. So I have there off to the side, which will start our, I have brown rice over here cooking for our stir fry. Now in making a traditional stir fry, one of the keys that people don't realize is that it's best to use your or make your rice the day before.
Really?
Yes, it's better to have rice that has been cooked and fully cooled in order to have a really great rice, because then once you do your stir fry, then you say your veggies, you want to saute up all your veggie stuff, you take that cooled rice and then you just basically put it in there, and once you stir it up, you're just bringing it back up to temp. Because if you use warm rice or rice you just cooked and then try to put it in there, there's still the starches that are still being released that will now make it more of a mushy and not have your fully the nice texture that you would want in a fried rice.
Okay, good to know.
Well, every time that I've tried to use leftover rice, it always seems to be like dried out and very hard. Is what am I doing wrong?
So it depends on once you cooked it. You cooked it all the way, and then you immediately cool it down, like rinse it with some cold water to immediately stop the cooking process when you originally cooked it. And then once you refrigerate it, once you go to put it all together as the stir fry, it should just technically you're just bringing it back up to temp. You're just heating it back through. So if you didn't cook it all the way when you first cooked it, then maybe that's.
Or stop hard. The cooking. Yeah, because I've never rinsed my rice off right away. So that's probably the step I was missing.
That's why you're here, Darlene. You're going to be an expert rice cooker when you're done.
Well, I always take notes every time, no matter which one of our cooking for wellness classes we have. I'm always writing notes because I always learn something new.
That's awesome. And I like to share ideas around food. I mean, everyone's experience is different, and you know what occurs as like an idea to you might not have ever occurred to someone else. So sharing all of that's super important.
Oh yeah, I wrote down Wendy's idea of the cabbage and the vinegar and the apple. I'm gonna be researching recipes for that.
Yeah, right.
So I'm making up a little, a dressing I would say, which is going to, I'm gonna stir fry or toss everything in, but it's a little rice vinegar, soy sauce, a little bit of honey to balance it out. I'm also adding honey in this because what the honey is going to do is also balance. Artichokes were in a brine, so there's going to be a little to it. So this honey is going to balance everything out. And then the gochujang can be kind of spicy. So that honey is going to also balance it. I like a little kick. Personally, but that honey will balance it. So you'll still get a little bit of kick, but then you'll get that sweetness also on the palate at the same time.
So which vegetables did you cut up, Chef?
onion, bell pepper, the artichokes, and the red cabbage.
Oh, okay.
And I have some ginger and garlic.
Okay.
So we're gonna put a little spoonful of the gochujang into our dressing.
So the dressing is honey,
soy, rice vinegar, sesame oil, garlic, ginger.
I bet that's fabulous. I like those flavors. Now, if you just had a few chopped peanuts for the top of the fried rice, that would be delish.
Oh, yes. A little sesame oil and whisk it real good. Whisk it real good. And you have to have sound effects and make your own music.
I'd like to see your dance moves as well.
Well, they're definitely not like Jagger's.
Well, you're not old enough to be like him. So, Lori, Chef is cooking up some brown rice with the, what's the difference nutritional-wise between that and like a white rice or even a minute rice?
Oh, so the brown rice just kind of speaks to the bran still being there. So it'll be higher in fiber, which what we know with fiber kind of speeds transit time in the bowel. So it's good for digestion. Plus it slows down how quickly your body can break that carb to break it down and get it into the bloodstream as sugar. And so if you're, working towards keeping your glucose and insulin ratio steady, brown rice is going to serve you better in that regard. So the more fiber, the better. That's kind of, I always look at that. I know we've talked about this in class before. I feel like if you really and truly pay attention to that 38 grams per day for men and 25 grams a day for women, you can get a really nutritious diet on board with that one guideline, because it'll always kind of guide you into fresh fruits and vegetables and whole grains, you know, trying to get that much fiber naturally. So, and I think it's nice, like the texture, it's heartier. It feels.
Yeah, it is. I remember when, you know, before brown rice really kind of got any type of respect, you know, it was one of those things where it was just really being introduced, you know, several years back, and everybody's like, oh, I don't like it. It doesn't have any flavor. But that was the one thing that I did appreciate about it. It does have a heartiness to it. Mm-hmm. You know, we could work with the flavor part of it, and everybody, if anybody's been in any of the classes we've done in the last year, I've told you guys several ways that you can impart flavor into it. So we can deal with that. But I think that's one of the turnoffs that people had, was, other than the flavor, was that they were used to regular rice. So it does have a different texture. It's kind of chewier and heartier, but that's not a bad thing.
No.
I think you talked about it, maybe I heard it somewhere else, that even chewing is beneficial, like the way we chew or how much we chew.
It was me, I think, 17 to 40 chews per bite. Like that's how we're supposed to chew each bite 17 to 40 times, but there's science behind that. Chewing or mastication is what the first stage of digestion, it actually signals the neurotransmission to begin producing digestive enzymes. And so that's a little bit of controversy around smoothies, that you don't chew them. And so the question is, do you have as much access to those foods that are blended and you're just drinking? Do you have the same access, because are you able to have the process started and ready to go to actually extract the nutrients as far as digestive enzyme capabilities. So it's a it's an interesting question. I've never read anything definitive, let me put it that way, on whether or not, you know, just drinking your smoothie, it you would assume that it's the same benefit as eating each and every one of those components.
Right.
A little bit of question on that. And so I did read recently, one way to combat that is to begin every meal, whether it's a smoothie or not, with a few bites of bitters. So like a bitter green, like arugula was one that was suggested. Just a few sprigs of arugula that you chew that, and that really aids digestion in regards to giving you enough enzyme capability to extract the nutrients and benefit from all of them.
Interesting.
Right?
So just keep some bitter greens or something around at every meal.
Yeah. Yeah. You can actually buy bitters like as a supplement. So that's interesting. They tend to be kind of expensive in my opinion. So to buy a little bit of arugula and chew that before I eat seemed like a way better idea to me. I mean, I don't know. Does anyone remember like where I remember seeing people using bitters before a meal was on Downton Abbey. Like,
did you
watch that series?
I did not.
Oh, it's, I loved it. It was so good. But they were like this, you know, this wealthy family, and they were served in the dining room and every night, and they always had bitters on the table before they dined. So
I would rather have an aperitif with Campari.
Say that again, Pat.
I would rather have an aperitif with Campari, which is like a bitter liqueur.
Oh.
I like a Campari and grapefruit, so you really get that tart bitterness.
Oh, okay. See, this is what I'm talking about. You got to school me on these things. I didn't even know that that would work. Very nice.
So well, Chef, what you got in your skillet?
Well, any stir fry, it's about over high heat, and especially with any vegetables in there, because you're going to make sure that you get all the moisture out of it and get some really nice saute on that, bring out some great natural flavors in that. So I've just put in my peppers and onions. Then I'm going to crush up some garlic and some ginger. We'll throw that in there, all what I call aromatics flavor.
Do you peel your ginger?
I do, but guess what? I was watching something the other day, and I saw Chef J.J. Johnson, who does not peel his ginger. Whenever he makes a dish, he actually puts the peel and all. And I was like, wow, that was the first time I had ever heard that. And because, of course, we've been talking about it, that a lot of nutrients are in the skins and peels of a lot of, you know, produce.
Yeah.
But I never thought of it when it came to, like, ginger.
Right. And then in onion, too, they say be really careful and don't peel away too much. And the whole rationale behind that, like the way that you can kind of make sense of it, is you want the part of the food that's closest to the sun.
Yes.
Interesting.
Yeah, no, I thought that was interesting. I actually learned that in a book called Eating on the Wild Side. Mm-hmm. And so that book, it kind of takes you through how to select produce, what you're looking for, what you're gonna get. Like, I mean, it breaks down everything, like every variety of apple, every variety of onion, I found it super interesting. I can't really remember everything that it went through, but because it's an entire book on produce, it teaches you how to, like, especially like if you're at a farmer's market, like what you're looking for, how to get like the varieties that tend to be the most nutrient dense. It's a really good book.
Interesting.
Yeah. Okay, so you've got your veggies flop in there. Nice, very pretty. I like the purple cabbage.
saute. I didn't add any salt because normally we would add some seasonings because there's going to be soy sauce in the dressing there. So we don't want to over salt or sodium this. We got our ginger and garlic we're going to put in there. Voila. My rice is done.
Did you cook the rice in broth?
I did cook it in broth.
So that's going to be a nice addition flavor-wise.
And now I'm going to rinse my rice to cool it down so that it works really well in this stir fry.
And if you're rinsing it, aren't you taking the flavor off of the chicken broth?
No, because it's not on the outside. It's been absorbed in the rice.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Because as that rice cooked, it absorbs. So it's taking that liquid now, and now it's within.
That was an excellent question.
You know, with canned vegetables, like say green beans, it's the actual vegetable that we looked at. There was a 30% sodium reduction when you rinsed them. So,
yeah. I rinsed all my canned food because of the high sodium content. Mm-hmm. If I can't find it frozen, it's going under the faucet.
Yeah. It's probably a good idea. It makes 30% is a big difference.
All right, so I've drained my tuna, and I don't want to break it up too much. I'm just kind of loosely, because I want some nice texture and chunks in there.
So the tuna's going in with your veggies?
Yes.
Okay. Do not try that at home, people.
It'd be all over my floor.
I do. I'm like, I'd be throwing that whole skillet worth of food in the floor.
I'm sure you guys can handle it. Now we'll take our dressing, our sauce. Oh, wow, this smells great.
If you do say so yourself.
If I say so myself. It's
mm-hmm. So Darlene can be the tester.
I'm looking forward to this.
See.
Well, it's going to be very nutritionally sound. You've got your cabbage, you've got your, and then chef added onion and pepper, garlic and ginger, which are very, have a lot of medicinal properties. And then the antioxidant rich gochujang.
Where are we going to find that chili paste in the grocery store?
Section of the grocery store. Mm-hmm. If you go in the Asian section of your grocery store, you'll find it right there.
Yeah, I made the mistake of going first to the sauce aisle at Giant Eagle, and they had the bibimbap had a honey. I'm like, wait a minute. I think I need to go to the Asian section. And sure enough, and there were several kind, and this is like the original. That's why I went with that. But yeah, it's right there, just on the shelf under the Asian section.
So I would be interested to see that container, like chef, when you get a minute. I know it's not right now, but I would like to see the container and what it looks like in the container. Yeah. I don't know if anybody else would like to see that.
I'll show you guys. So what I've done is I've added an egg to this because you can't have fried rice without an egg.
No.
What I did was I created a well in the middle so that this is a one pot dish, a one pan dish, I should say. I'm sorry, two if we count the pot that we cook the fried rice in. I'm sorry, the rice. So our egg is cooked. We'll add our rice. We'll fold everything together.
So if you didn't want to use rice, you could definitely use quinoa.
Yes.
Oh. Quinoa is a nice option. It's higher in protein than rice. So there's nothing wrong with brown rice, but sometimes you want a little variety. So quinoa is a nice way to add variety in your grain.
Let's plate it up.
Lori, what are the different nutrients in like the red or purple rice?
Well, the purple and red both are higher in that anti-aging compound that I was talking about. There's several of them, but the group is called anthocyanin. And so anything like blueberries, blackberries, raspberries, purple onion,
black rice.
They all are higher in those compounds, and they're associated with, we say anti-aging, but a lot of the research was done around heart health and just total body inflammation reduction, and they're key to that. And so, you know, a purple rice or a red, you know, black rice, all of those have more of those compounds. Wow, that's a lot of food.
Sure is.
Right? You could have leftovers for days.
This would be a great breakfast.
I would eat that for breakfast.
Did the cabbage turn kind of gray when you cooked it?
No.
Lose it?
It's nice and vibrant purple.
Mine turns gray.
Yeah, how do you keep it from turning to gray?
Well, maybe because we cooked it right on high heat. And so it didn't have chance to turn a color. I can't even explain how that, because mine just never turned gray.
Oh,
that's because you went to culinary school.
No.
We did not.
That has nothing to do with it.
Well, we're doing a before and after picture. So I took a picture of the ingredients before. We'll get an after, and then we'll be able to see tonight when Chef gets us a little closer to the camera, but we also be able to see on our photo ops.
If he's telling the truth.
I just read something yesterday that when you cook purple cabbage, if you have something like vinegar in there, it helps preserve the color. So there was the rice vinegar was in that mixture of the sauce.
That's true. Good point.
I didn't add that until after I cooked it.
Well,
we're pretty sure it's going to be gray, so we'll see.
Oh, in Doubting Thomas's, we have to see to believe.
Maxine and I are like, our cabbage turns gray, so we want to see one that doesn't.
Absolutely. My last one did. It's not a feeling when it turns gray then.
Take your glasses off. Then you know you can't see it.
It's the glasses, guys. It's the glasses.
Time I made a zucchini cake, or no, it was a carrot cake, and I used pre-shredded carrots from the store. And when I pulled the cake out of the oven, the carrots turned green. So it's just marketing, folks. I just changed the name of the cake to zucchini cake.
There you go. Like, of course, it's supposed to be green.
That's quite interesting.
Yeah, that was pretty weird.
Yes. Makes you wonder.
And we survived. We did survive.
Good.
All right.
The unveiling.
Right? The unveiling.
too dark.
That looks yummy. That
looks beautiful.
Delicious, Jason. That's a super way to use purple cabbage.
Yeah, really is.
Very nice.
Okay.
So we've got our artichokes in there, some red pepper, the purple cabbage, the tuna. And if you notice, I added the tuna there really once everything else was warmed. And you guys didn't know, after I had sauteed the vegetables and everything, I added the tuna, I had turned the heat off because already the pan is already hot. You don't cook totally, you just want to warm the tuna, because then it would break it down too much. It would change the texture of it. And remember when I was breaking it apart, I wanted those nice chunks. I didn't want it to end up like tuna fish, like tuna salad. So we had those nice texture chunks in there. So just enough to warm it through right when we added the rice. So I added the tuna, then we added that cooled rice. Once you toss everything out, that residual heat was going to warm everything the rest of the way through in there.
And Chef, did you want to show us the chili paste?
Oh.
I chickened out of saying it.
Once you get one of these, because they're about $7 for the container. So once you get it, it's going to last you quite a while. Once you open it, you have to refrigerate it. And it will last you a long time because a little bit goes a long way. This isn't anything that you're going to be just putting spoonfuls in. I think I put maybe a tablespoon's worth in to make this dressing or sauce. But yeah, and it gave it a nice little kick. If you're not a person that likes any type of spice, then you need to do a half a tablespoon. But a little bit goes a long way, and you can use this for all kinds of things. So you can use it and make it as a dressing for a salad, Asian salad with some Napa cabbage or some bok choy and shred it up, some cilantro, some shredded carrots, some peanuts, and you can make a nice Asian salad, some cucumbers, and then you can whip up a dressing kind of like I did with this and add that little kick to it. Lori, is there any research? I love spicy stuff. My daughter likes spicy stuff. But is there some research about what that does to the body or what it activates as far as spice?
Well, a little bit is the capsaicin. It's a natural analgesic. We know that. And then what did we just talk? Who, Maxine, what else did you say with the spice?
No, you were just talking about it.
Oh, okay.
The metabolism. Yeah.
Yes, metabolism. It was Pat. Yes. So yeah, good for the metabolism and pain relief.
Good.
It is interesting how some people really love spice and some are so averse to it. So
I had a client before who really could not have any spice, like black pepper really would send her. I'm like, black pepper? She's like, I can't have even black, just ground black pepper, because it would just be way too much for her. And I'm like, wow.
Yeah.
Jeez.
Yeah, it's a wide range on that for sure. Because I've known people that can't stand black pepper, not even black pepper. So it's interesting.
Okay.
Well,
that was really good. I think that looks delish. Darlene will have to make her way over and let us know.
Yes, I will. I'll do that now.
Really quick, very simple. It really doesn't take a lot of culinary ingeniousness. It's just, you know, one, having a really good pan. You don't have to have a wok, but to have a really good pan that, you know, like I said, the key was that we cooked this over high heat, because with those vegetables, you don't want them to just be soggy. You want them to get that little bit of caramelization. You want them to kind of cook quickly. If you notice, you go into any Asian restaurant or so something like that, they have those woks going over high heat, and that high heat is cooking that stuff really quick. because then it also is going to lend to where it's going to be a little bit of texture to that. And then, like I said, then we put everything else in. So everything was able to keep cooking really quickly. So it's something that won't take long to be able to do. Probably the longest out of this dish was just cooking the rice. But if you do that the day before, then the day of, you could have this done and on the table in about 10 minutes.
That sounds good.
If you cook your rice the day before, cool it down, rinse it, and cool it down, put it in the refrigerator, the next day, say for lunch, or breakfast, you could definitely, at this point, you're just sauteing those vegetables off really quickly, and then you're throwing in your tuna or shrimp. Some shrimp would be great. Putting everything in there and then warming that rice through, throw your egg in there. Or you could take an egg and do an over medium egg and put right on top. So maybe you don't have to scramble it in there like a regular rice. Take an over medium egg and put it and cook it. And then once you put it all together, sit it right on top. And then you cut into that yolk and, oh, okay.
Very nice. Good ideas.
So that, let me get a pic of this. You want me to grab that right away? I think it might be good. Okay. We've all learned the power of the ring light and of lighting for pictures. Because, you know, nobody likes your stuff if it doesn't look like it's leaping off of the plate. This is one of those lessons we've learned this year. Is that right, Darlene?
That's right.
Thanks, guys. Great program.
Any Bye-bye. Other questions or anything, anybody? Before the holiday? This will be the last time we will see everyone on this side of 2020.
I was going to say that if you have a bowl of rice and it's a little bit hard that you had in your fridge, if you take a teaspoon of water and put in it and put it in the microwave, it will make it soft again.
Yep.
Because I do with my rice.
I have to tell you guys, this is delicious.
It looks like it.
Over was just wonderful, but having a bite, I'm like, oh, Def, I'm looking forward to you writing this recipe up. This is one that I will be making at home.
Wow. Okay.
Thank you, Chef Jason.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Good to see you all.
Thank you, Lori.
You're welcome.
Thank you, and Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Happy holidays. And don't forget to log on tonight for Funny on Purpose.
Okay.
All right.
Bye, everyone.
Have a great weekend and a wonderful holiday. Happy New Year's to every one of you. Be safe and be well.
And we'll see you next year ready to cook some more, huh?
Ready to cook some more. Let's do
it. All right. Thanks.
Thank you, guys.
Happy holidays, everybody.
Hi everybody.